Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this funeral mass we celebrate for the repose of the soul of Ivy Elizabeth Sedgman. We come together in faith and hope to give thanks for the life of Ivy and to offer our support, comfort and prayers to her children Ray, Greg, Mark, Helen, their loved ones, families and friends. Under COVID arrangements, we ask you to respect the safety of the family and of each other today by keeping strict social distancing. Our presider today is Father Carol.
We come together in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And the Lord be with you. These are strange times to come together, but at least we have the opportunity to be able to come together. In so many countries, because of the COVID, families are not allowed anywhere near people who have died, not just of COVID, but have died anyway. So we do great honour to be able to come together. And particularly, I want to thank Ray, Greg, Mark and Helen for inviting us today. It's wonderful to gather around the body of a loved one and remember God's goodness to her, because I think she shared some of that goodness with us all. And we'll hear about that in a minute. When Ivy was baptized, she was baptized into the promise of eternity. And God keeps promises. It might take us a little while to awaken to that promise and to treat it with some seriousness. But I'll tell you what, God works hard to make sure that we all get home. So we always start with the sprinkling of the coffin with some water, which I'll take from our font. To remember the promise made so long ago. I spoke with Helen earlier. There's two people who are virtually with us today, Teresa Woolwork and her mum. Teresa was a little child when Ivy and her darling husband were the godparents. All right? So she made those connections in the promise with others as well too. So that lovely gesture, simplicity of water, I'll get it, and Helen is going to sprinkle the coffin for us today. Be generous with a sprinkle. God's generous with promises. Lovely. Well done. I'd ask Ray, Greg and Mark to come forward now as well, because we're going to lay the pall and some little objects, little symbols of affection. Now I need two of you to come and take this. Just lay it on just like that and just unfold it. There we go. Sure, it's just the middle line. Beautiful. Is it straight? Yes? That did a good job. Good on you. And I'd say the three boys, actually the four of you, go over, and with Mum and Dad's picture there, the wedding photograph, and also the other little symbols as well too, and just lay them gently on the coffin. Yes, that's nice. Little prayer book, prayer of rosary beads, and also understand a little cross necklace as well too. These are the enduring symbols of her faith life, which of course spilled out into the love of those around her. Well, I'd ask you to be seated now, and I invite Helen to come forward and tell us a little bit about this remarkable lady we call Ivy affectionately today. Good on you. Is it on?
start again? All right, we'll start again.
My brothers and I are grateful for the presence of our families, friends, and those watching from afar as we come together to celebrate a life well lived, that of our dear Mum. Mum was an extraordinary woman with a strong faith and an undying love for her family. She was there for us in the hard times and enjoyed celebrating the joys of life with us. Mum and Dad's home was a place where we often came together, and Mum always had delicious baking waiting for us. I'd just like to read a few words that Mum jotted down before her health declined. Ivy Elizabeth was born in Cairns on 5th of October 1923, a healthy 10-pound baby to parents Bert and Ivy Ray of Ainslie. She had an older brother, Les, and a younger one, Vince. Life was good, but uneventful in the little bush town. Ivy spent her schooling in the old bush school. Her father, Bert Ray, bought the store and post office to keep his children in employment, and Ivy ran the post office for several years. Life was good at Ainslie, with dances, tennis, and good times at Kidston, Mount Surprise, Forsyth, and Georgetown. The bright lights of Cairns were beckoning, and when a job was offered to Mum by the Cairns post office inspector, Mum accepted with great enthusiasm. Her grandmother, Granny Reed, travelled to Cairns with Ivy to make a home for them both. They settled into a flat at 9 Sheridan Street, where they lived happily for several years. Coming from a quiet country post office to a busy one in the centre of Cairns was a big change for her. The war was on, and Cairns was alive with Australian and American troops, which often ended up in conflict on the post office corner. Ivy was promoted to the inspector's branch of the post office, and from there went to Atherton, where she met a nice young man named Harold Sedgman, a postal clerk from Rockhampton. A romance blossomed. I love that bit. Mum and Dad's wedding in the Ainslie Hall was no doubt the highlight of the year, with over 400 people present. Everyone from the outlying stations was in attendance. Our parents lived in many towns over North Queensland as Dad sought promotion in the post office. Hence, my brothers and I are all born in various locations. Mum and Dad finally retired to Cairns and enjoyed many years together with their ever-expanding family before it was no longer possible for them to live on their own. Dad passed in 2017. Mum and Dad were married for nearly 69 years. It's been difficult for our family to witness Mum's decline these last few years, as she was such a vibrant, intelligent lady who was loved by all. We all have our special memories of Mum, and I know she would want us to remember those times as we move forward with our lives. We couldn't have asked for a better matriarch of our family. We love you, Mum, and it gives us great comfort to know that you are now at peace.
Thank you, Helen. We start with a little prayer, just to collect our thoughts. God of our ancestors in faith, by the great covenant of love, you taught your people to strengthen the bonds of family through faith, honour, and love. Look kindly upon Ivy, a wife, a mother, a grandmother, and a great-grandmother, and a friend, who sought only to do good for others in all that she did. Bring her to her heavenly home, where with all the saints she may dwell in blessedness and peace. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. I'll ask Julie now to come forward. Julie is going to share a few thoughts from St. Paul. Yes, yeah. Who wrote several letters, but he wrote this letter, one or two letters that we have to the church in Corinth. The Corinthians were a rebellious group, so he had to write to them a few times, but he gave some great advice.
A reading from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. The response is, thanks be to God. We know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and will bring us with you into his presence. Yes, everything is for your sake, so that grace, as it extends to more and more people, may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart. Even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure, because we look not at what can be seen, but at what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. And today we're going to read the psalm together, this lovely psalm of the Good Shepherd. The words are probably familiar to most in different forms, but they reassure us again that we're always looked after. We're always cared for by a God that loves us dearly. And together, the Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want. Fresh and green are the pastures where he gives me repose. Near restful waters he leads me to revive my drooping spirit. He guides me along the right path. He is true to his name. If I should walk in the valley of darkness, no evil would I fear. You are there with your crook and your staff. With these you give me comfort. You have prepared a banquet for me in the sight of my foes. My head you have anointed with oil. My cup is overflowing. Surely goodness and kindness shall follow me all the days of my life. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell forever and ever. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me, says Jesus. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated again. the real assurance in readings that we have at funeral masses and in funeral services generally. They're there to help to reassure us in some ways and to connect us to something bigger as well. It's not just a matter of a life of one person who died. It's a matter of our humanity being challenged through the death of one person. So whereas Ivy would have challenged the family and friends into a way of looking at life which was wonderful, which was good, which was wholesome, which was loving, which was filled with the sense of the presence of God, so also in her death she challenges us to look at the same things. And it's God that challenges through our lives and through Ivy's death at the moment. So this letter to the Corinthians, like I said, they were a difficult group of people. They're a very large city. They're like a metropolitan city of the time. And so like all our big cities, they're filled with all sorts of chaos and confusion. So in the middle of this, there was a small group of people that had gathered around Paul when he visited them and were now asking a lot of questions about life. Questions that we're often left with in death too. Why? Why do they need to suffer? Why do they need to go so young? All these things. And we ask them of God because we don't know where else to ask them. You know, we give God a good bashing when it comes to death. God's big enough. There's nothing to fear. Big enough. And we'll know all the answers one day ourselves. But Paul writes here that even when our outer nature is wasting away, there is something within us. Our inner nature grows day by day. Almost very poetic. Our inner nature is being renewed day by day. I think people of the age of Ivy and of Harold and all the years they spent together would well have known how difficult life was. And even to endure it was quite a remarkable feature of sort of the rough area of this land up here. It's not all milk and honey. It's pretty tough stuff sometimes too. But even in that roughness, even in the challenges, there was something inside of them was growing. Day by day it was being renewed, their love for each other, for their family, for the people around them. And in a sense, they were growing in understanding of what might lie ahead. Paul says, the eternal weight of glory beyond all measure will be there for us. And they're not just nice words, they're promises. There is something ahead of us that we don't yet see. But it'd be nice to start seeing it here. And that's why we're asked to be good to others, particularly at this time of pandemic, so that others have a sense of hope, that there is something beyond all of this as well. And then in this lovely little gospel, we have this remarkable character that pops his head up called Thomas. We know him as Thomas the Doubter, but really he's a delightful character. I say this often when Thomas's name comes up. He doesn't sort of ask the question, you know, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? He has a real spirit about him, you know. He challenges Jesus. It's all well and good for you. You know where you're going. And you say all these things, but how do we know where you're going? So how do we go and know the way? He throws the challenge out, and Jesus accepts it with humility and meekness, as Jesus did. Hey, I'm the way. If you relate to me, all your questions will come to fruition. If you have a sense of me in the presence of all things, which I think that Ivy and Harold would have had, even in the simple words that Helen mentioned and what other people have said to me about them as well, that Jesus, in relationship with us, makes all things possible. The futility of our world and its current chaos pales into insignificance as well. A wise man many years ago, in the century before this one, in the early part of that century, was teaching his students in an abbey once, and about death and dying. And one of the students came to him afterwards and quite worried about what happens after death. So Thomas, his name was, said, "What makes you think that they go anywhere? They just disappear and they're gone from everything?" He said, they live in our hearts, they live in our memories. They've left traces of their humanity and of God's divinity in them, in everything they touched in the universe. And it's all still there. Why would God take that away? You know, so as God's fingerprint is in everything, in every living creature, so the little fingerprint of our existence stays part of all of that. I was at St. Mary's College some few months ago, bringing into full communion one of the teachers there, and we want to do it with the kids in grade 10. Shouldn't call them kids, so that they could see the life of the church in a different kind of way. And I asked them if they were doing science, and some of them, you know, not grade 10 kids alike, you know, yeah. And I said, in your science, you will know that there's a law of I think it's thermodynamics, which says that nothing that is destroyed actually changes. The very essence of what has been destroyed remains in our universe. In other words, in my prayer later on, we'll say, for us, life is changed, not ended. So keep your memories, keep them alive. Keep in your hearts dearly what Ivy meant to you and what Ivy wanted to mean to others as well. And be reassured that as our earthly, our external nature changes, as it rightly does because of old age and the weathering of our bodies, that something inside gets renewed every day, and that ultimately we will find the way, the truth, and the life. It is God's promise, and God keeps the promise. I'm going to ask Caleb now to come forward and to help us pray for those that we need to pray for today. Thank you, Caleb. God, the Almighty Father, raised Jesus, our Christ, from the dead. And so, with confidence, we ask God to save all people, living and dead.
In baptism, Ivy was given the pledge of eternal life. May he now be admitted to the great company of saints. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Ivy was nourished by the word and life of Jesus our Lord. May she be raised up on the last day. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of our sister Ivy, that they may be consoled in their grief. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who looked out for Ivy during her long life, and particularly in her later years, that they may be rewarded for their professionalism and care. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Harold, Ivy's beloved husband, and all our deceased relatives and friends, that they may have eternal reward of their goodness. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who suffer in any way through this time of COVID-19 pandemic, that their compassion and resilience may embrace the most vulnerable. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer. God, our shelter and strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed loved one. Forgive Ivy her sin and grant her the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, we prepare now for our Eucharist, which is just a fancy word for celebration. A great thanksgiving to God for the gift of Ivy and all that is wonderful in our world. So I ask Sue and Lynn just to pop up, and you can bring them and put them on the table when you come up. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. May the offering of these gifts, the work of creation and of human endeavour, be pleasing to you, Lord, so that the soul of your servant Ivy, finding in your mercy the pardon and grace that she sought, may exult forever with the company of saints and praise your glory for all eternity, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus the Christ, by the power and working of Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus the Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, Therese, Mary MacKillop, and all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and James our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Ivy, called from this world to yourself. Grant that she, who was united with your Son, in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection, when, from the earth, he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours for ever and ever.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Well, let's stand and we pray this remarkable prayer. You know, we glibly say it, but the words are very clear, you know. Formed by divine teaching, our Saviour's command, we dare to say it. We dare to acknowledge that God is Father. As Ivy was mother, grandmother, wife, great-grandmother, and that friend, there's something bigger that draws us together today with her. And so we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin, and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus the Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sin, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Peace of the Lord be with you always. Thank you. Safely now, share that peace with one another. Family groups, you can hug and kiss. Friends, you can just say hi.
Lamb of God, you take
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. The body of Christ. The blood of Christ. Just take the jug. Good on you. Because of the COVID restrictions, we can't share the cup, but there is in the Christian tradition little glasses. So we've adopted that from our Christian brothers and sisters in other communions. This should be a day when people feel that they should come to communion if they're able to. If you've been away for a while, hey, as the Pope says, communion is a healing salve for the soul. It's not a reward for good behaviour at all. And if you'd like to also receive from the cup, please there, and Wayne will help.
Angels' toils and snares, I have.
Renewed by this life-giving sacrament of love, we pray, O Lord, that the soul of our sister Ivy, to whom you willingly gave a part of your eternal covenant, may be purified by the power of this mystery and rejoice without end in the peace of our Christ, who lives and reigns with you and Holy Spirit forever and ever. Amen. With faith in Jesus Christ, we now reverently bring the body of our sister to be buried in its human imperfection. Let us pray with confidence to God, who gives life to all things, that God will raise up this mortal body to the perfection and the company of the saints. May God give her a merciful judgment and forgive all her sin. May Christ, the Good Shepherd, lead her safely home, to be at peace with God our Father, and may she be happy forever with all the saints in the presence of the eternal King. We now prepare her body in this coffin to be taken from here to its place of burial, and thus we need to remove our little Christian symbols and our pall. Those who have laid them, would you please come and remove them again? There's no right or wrong way, just good on you. That's lovely. And just on there again, thank you. Beautiful. And so we sing our farewell by saying our farewell. Saints of God, come to her aid. Come to meet her, angels of the Lord. Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. May Christ, who called her, take her to himself. May angels lead her to Abraham's side. Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. May the saints receive her into paradise and welcome her into their company. Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. May she find that Christ is with her still and recognize with joy her Lord and Saviour. Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. Let her know Christ as a brother and share to the full in our Christ's risen life. Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. Father of mercies, into your hands we commend our sister. Not a lovely commend. It's a word we don't use much of. It says she was good. She was a good person. And we can commend that goodness to you. You know, presumptuous because God already knows, but we need to be able to say it. We are confident that with all who have died in Christ, she will be raised to life on the last day and live with Christ forever. We thank you for all the blessings that you gave her in this life, through which she shared so much with others. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, hear our prayer. Welcome our sister to paradise and help us to remain to comfort one another with the assurance of our faith until we all meet in Christ to be with you and with our sister forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Saviour God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Saviour God, to thee. How great thou art, how great. Mountain grandeur, and hear the brook, and feel the gentle breeze. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and dare proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul.